What's up, guys? How you doing? I am Kevin Polowy. Something still feels off about this mic if there's a sound man in the house. How fucking great is this movie? Oh my goodness. I don't think this is a surprise. I think you guys know this, but there are some very, very special guests, clearly, in the house tonight, and we're going to bring them up right now. Mr. Kumail Nanjiani. Emily B. Gordon. And Kurt Braunohler. Hey guys.
Hello everyone. Thank you so much for coming to see our movie.
The feels that movie gives you. I mean, I just saw the last 5 minutes again. I had seen it twice before, but it all came rushing back in those last few minutes. You guys, congrats on this movie. It is getting raves, deservedly so, all over the place.
Thank you.
I just have to say, I mean, Kumail and Emily, just seeing you guys here tonight at this Q&A, and seeing you guys so happily married all these years later, just feels like the perfect epilogue to this incredible true story.
Yeah, you guys are getting the sequel live in front of you.
Yeah, I've seen some reviews that are like positive, but they're like, I mean, the fact they're married really gives the ending away. Like, there's really no way around that. I'm not gonna fake the death of my wife for a box office. And we didn't think of that.
So tell us, like, at what point did you guys decide to tell this story?
There was no real one moment, I would say, that we were like, this has got to be a movie. About 5 years ago, which is about 5 years after the events, are you going to...
Yeah, I'm gonna take a picture.
And then it's like, I could be saying anything because you guys are posing for a photo.
act natural.
That we started talking about possibly turning this into a movie because it's such a specific story. Like, if we didn't tell the story, nobody... You guys are acting natural. If we didn't tell the story, nobody else would or could. And then when Judd Apatow tells you that that's the movie that you're going to write, you're like, yes, sir, and you get to work. So we did.
Yeah, it was about 5 years ago, 5 years after the events, yeah.
So it wasn't that night in New York City that the film ends on?
It was actually day two of the coma, and I was like, this is going to be a great movie.
You can tell.
You know, by
look in your eye in the hospital.
By day two, you're kind of used to it.
That's how she woke up, is the tip-tap of the typewriter.
I was like, oh good, I'll rewrite the ending. I'm so sorry. No, it was, you know, sometimes people ask, like, so when you were going through it, were you like, this would be a great story? And I was like, no. It felt like, I hope, you know, it's just very dark going through it. It really was, for a long time, it was like paralyzing to think about it. At least for me, I'm sure. Yeah, it was very paralyzing. Kurt didn't give a fuck. Kurt was like, are we still talking about the coma? Jeez.
Not only plays the very lovingly annoying best friend in the movie, who is Kumail's roommate. He also was our on-set joke writer.
Boom.
So he got to write jokes for Holly Hunter on a near daily basis.
Which is a terrifying situation when you walk into it. Because when Holly Hunter's like, give me some jokes, and then you give them to her, and she just goes, and you just give her 10 jokes, and then you're like, oh no, she hates all of them! And then she like does them and kills them and does them really well. You're like, oh, this is
Yeah, she just doesn't suffer fools to be like, oh, that's a fun idea. She's just taking it in.